Hello again and welcome to Sudson Country Video. Hi, I'm Herb Sudson. On this show, I would like to say, ladies and gentlemen, the Statler Brothers.
Yay! All right. Thank you. Appreciate it.
When somebody announces, ladies and gentlemen, the Statler Brothers, did that still get you excited the way it did 25 years ago?
Well, you know right then it's time to go to work.
It sure is, yeah.
You jump up and you just run towards the microphone, and wherever they set it up, you go do
it. That's
it,
no matter where it is,
that's
huh?
That's exactly right.
The excitement is there.
Oh, yeah, the people are over half of the show. When they're excited, we're excited. And so as soon as we hear them, we're immediately
you're gone.
Ready to go. That's right.
You guys have won over 400 awards in your years singing, playing country music.
Is that
folks.
Right?
Now, I would like to tell me some of the unusual awards that you have won out of those 400.
The unusual
ones?
Gee, they all mean a lot to us. There's awards that come from the fans. There's awards that come from the industry, that come from the record companies. All those, they all mean something different to you. We've had awards given to us from local civic organizations and things when we go in on tour in different towns. I'm hard-pressed to think of any particular unusual one, but
I guess the most unusual awards you get are people give you the key to the city and don't tell you where the lock is.
Yeah, good point.
Yeah, that's
fairly unusual. Yeah. And there's a couple of times we just had to leave town because we couldn't get it unlocked. But we still got the keys, I want to tell you that.
You've been referred to as America's Poets. Would you like to say something about being America's Poets? Does that reflect in your songs?
I think it reflects on the way we can make two words rhyme. That's usually what makes a poet.
Yeah, Kurt Vonnegut called us America's Poets,
right.
And it's a very kind thing that he said, and we appreciate it, in his book, Palm Sunday. And we're very honored by it. For anybody that feels like we are, we're happy, and we certainly, we just do what we know best to do, and it's worked for us.
Does poetry and songwriting go hand in hand?
They are not the same thing, but they go hand in hand. Yeah, a poet is not necessarily a songwriter and vice versa. There's a whole different meter and way to go about writing both. But yes, they're cousins anyway.
That's why they reflected you as, labeled you as America's Poets. Mm-hmm. Over the years, you've been playing, singing country music for about 25 years, give or take a year, day or two.
Mm-hmm.
Has your music ever strayed from country music or from country roots?
We don't feel like it has. If it has, we didn't aim for it to happen. I don't think so. We aim everything country to the country audience because that is our basic audience.
Because years ago, country music kind of strayed a little bit, and was kind of weaving around and kind of didn't find itself for a while. I just wonder if you've had any crossovers or any.
Well, we've had lots of crossover, and I don't think country music ever strays. I think people stray. I think country music stays the same, pretty much.
Didn't the sound change a little bit?
Well, possibly so, but I think it always kind of goes in that circles, either a wide circle or a shorter circle, but it always comes back. And we've always tried just to pretty much stay where we knew what we were doing and with our audience and pleasing the folks that appreciate us, and that's where we want to be.
Is that what makes the Statler Brothers constant hit makers?
I guess. I think it's probably because that we do stay within the realms of where we know that people want to hear us and what they want to hear.
I looked over your discography, and there hasn't been a year missed since 1965 that you guys didn't have at least two hits out there and two records somewhere on the charts.
We've been very fortunate, very fortunate.
How many records have you had on the charts over the 25 years? Anybody know?
I don't know.
Don't have those numbers at fingertips, I'm sorry to say.
Albums? How many albums you guys?
I don't even know that.
30 something.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Yeah, there's a lot of them. Who writes all the songs on these albums?
Well, it's
Harold and Don and Jim, most of them. Yeah.
Yeah, we write most all of our music.
Oh, for all the albums? You don't sing? You don't?
Oh, we have done. We do other songs. Yeah. We're open to other songs, but basically, where it works out, we write about 90% of everything we do.
Jimmy, you wrote a song. How many songs have you written since you've been with the group?
Oh, I don't know how many exactly I've written. We've recorded probably maybe 8 or 9 of them, I think.
Any number one hits out of there?
Yeah, I've had, let's see, 3 number one songs.
What were they?
Elizabeth was the first, My Only Love, and Too Much on My Heart.
Gospel music as an education. Mm-hmm. Explain. Anybody?
That was our education of the business. We grew up on the Southern gospel groups like the Statesman Quartet, the Blackwood Brothers, the Harvesters. We went to all their concerts. when we were kids, and that's what we learned to sing. And basically what we're still doing musically are the gospel harmonies that we learned as kids, and we just took those gospel harmonies, put country lyrics to them, and created our own style.
Gospel and country hand in hand?
Yeah.
Now, I saw you do the show, and you do a song without any instruments.
Mm-hmm.
That's because, is that gospel related?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's a gospel song that we do. We do a couple every night. We always do. We always include a gospel song on every album, on every concert. And it's, like I say, there's our roots, and it's very special to us. We wouldn't do a concert without doing that.
Singing without instruments, a cappella? That's what they call it.
That's what they call it. Mm-hmm.
Yep. I saw that on a blue. I was talking to a bluegrass band, and that's what they call it. How has country music changed since the days of Flowers on the Wall, going back 25 years?
How has country
music and writing, or country music or anything, has changed over the years? Has it, maybe?
Oh yeah. In the time that we've been in the business, we've seen country music change three or four times. It goes around. It comes. In the '60s, we saw the strings come in, and right. You got that lush sound. Then it started getting come back around to more traditional sounds. Then in the 70s, it went more rock country, come back around the traditional, and it goes all the time. Right now, it's back, and the traditional thing seems to be where most of the artists are. So it's always in a constant revolution, but it's a small circle it makes, and it comes back to where it's supposed to be.
Why are they bringing back the old hits? A lot of these entertainers today bringing back old hits. Does that mean that the songwriting from the old days is better than today's songwriting?
No, I think because the audience is that there's a new audience out there that's never heard these old hits. They go back to the 50s, right. Or the early 60s, they get songs, and the record buyers today say, hey, it's a good song, never heard it before, because they have it. It was before their time, so it's like having a new song.
Like having a new song, but for us seasoned the country folks.
Seasoned, I like
seasoned
that.
Seasoned country folks, how about that one?
Yeah, we know them all, yeah.
And we're going back with the same songs.
Mm-hmm.
I think the reason country music is constantly changing, I think radio is the reason for it, because that way, if you put out a song they don't like, they can say it's too country, and if you put out the next one they don't like, they can say it's not country enough. So you never keep you off balance all the time, so you never know exactly what to do.
Yeah, who do you believe?
You can't believe anybody.
The fans.
the fans. Don't listen to anybody.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. Don's an avid reader. Does it show up in your songwriting?
Oh, possibly. I don't know. I learned to write probably by reading. I think that's the first step.
You use experiences that you've read. When you write a song, do you use experiences from life, or do you use experiences that you've read about in different...
Say books. Don't yeah. Say books.
You blame it on what you read if it gets too hot. Yeah, you do a little bit of everything. You write from things that happen to you, things you hear other people relate to you.
Or things you wish would happen to you.
Yeah.
Sometimes you write about those, too.
That's all daydreaming? Or?
Yeah, all daydreaming.
All daydreaming, yep. But you put in words and...
I've had very little experience, but I've had a lot of daydreaming.
I think a lot
he
of...
He majored in daydreaming.
Yes,
in school.
I did.
A lot of us can relate to that.
I did it so well, they sent me home a couple of times to do it.
Over the... going back 25 years... When you first start out with Flowers on the Wall, who gave you, how'd you get your break in the business?
Johnny Cash was our absolute beginning. He heard us and offered us a job and put us on his show, and on a handshake, we were with him for 8.5 years. So our beginnings of ever, we owe a lot to John. We're still grateful to him to this day.
Was he an idol of yours before you started into the business?
Yeah,
most definitely.
He was definitely. Yeah, we grew up on him. I mean, as listening to his early records, and yes, we were fans, and felt we were very fortunate to be able to, like Don said, we went to work with him on a handshake. It was our 8.5 years. We found out later if we'd signed a contract, he paid us.
We didn't know how it worked right
then. We didn't know exactly how it worked.
That's one of the instruments in business, huh?
Yes, it is.
Over the years of being on the road, give me just a ballpark number. How many miles have you guys traveled?
Oh, good land.
Just a curiosity.
25 years, so probably 1.5 miles or so. I don't know.
I'm just
probably a couple of million, maybe. I don't know.
I just came up with that question.
Dale's already gone over 1 million.
Watch right here. That's right.
Jimmy, you take it in.
Take it, Jimmy. I'd say about 6 million.
Six million.
I'm sure. Since I've been here. That's
okay.
That ain't been, what, 2 weeks?
Yeah, a couple weeks.
We travel fast.
How do you guys handle fans? You know, you
oh, have depends on what they look like.
We were dealing with two sold out shows here. Now you have to do something to cater to the fans. Now, what do you do? I heard about the 4th of July
during the show, or after the show, or
just all right, during the show, you cater to the fans. You play to the fans?
Always.
Oh, yeah.
Always.
Sure.
Now, you look at your audience and you size them up and you decide what they'll put up with and what they won't, and you go right up to the limit and stop. That's usually how you have to play it.
How about your 4th of July party?
Well, it's a party that we have in our hometown every 4th of July. It's all for charity. It's a free show. We do it each year, usually with a guest that comes and does it with us for absolutely nothing. And it's a big two-day event. And our little town of 22,000 people swells to about 75,000 and 80,000. And we have a big time.
My only love.
I think I'll take that one. And My Only Love was a special, special video for us because Harold got to get married in this thing. This was a real serious thing.
I remember it now.
And we all got to watch him, you know, and kind of make fun of him behind the scenes, you know. But it was a really nice video. Came off real good, did real good for us, and we enjoyed doing it.
Whatever.
Whatever is a video that we did, and you asked, we were talking earlier about how do we treat our fans. This is kind of the way sometimes you'd like to treat your fans, but they don't always look this good. This is a girl that we're singing, and we look out in the audience and spot her, and each one of us sort of daydream a little bit, but we always come back to reality, so whatever.
The video is Elizabeth.
Elizabeth, the first song that Jimmy wrote that was a big record for us. It features four different periods of times. We each hunting a girl, each have a girl, I'm sorry, and we don't make it with the girl. She leaves us. We're left high and dry. It's kind of a sad little thing.
Well, I certainly hope you enjoyed this Statler Brother video show, and I want to thank, of course, my co-host for the Statler Brothers.
Yeah, thank you.
We enjoyed it.
All right. This is Herb Southern. Until next time, hope you enjoyed the show.